Derek, Steve.
Derek,
thanks for doing this.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks for having me.
Can I offer you gentlemen some coffee?
Please.
It's cup of coffee, so I will have some coffee.
Yes, absolutely.
In my first watch mug.
Nice. Nice little plug there.
Thank you.
So you come here a lot, right? You live right down the road?
Yeah, we've been here for breakfast actually just recently, like a couple days ago.
This place is fantastic,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's great.
I'll be back.
So do you feel like after all that time in New York, do you feel now like a Valley guy? It's been a couple of years now.
I think it was crazy how fast I felt like a Valley guy.
Really?
Once I first got here. I mean, me and my wife, you live in New York City and it's moving and grooving.
Oh, yeah.
And you're nonstop. And in our first year here, we were like, yeah, this is, we can get used to this. So it didn't take us long to be Valley people.
I get it. Cause I worked in Midtown Manhattan for a year. I'm from Boston and I lived in New England most of my life. But you come out here and you do acclimate very quickly.
Yeah.
Living out here asks very little of you, I find. It's very easy to navigate. The weather's fantastic. The people are great. It right away you feel at home. I found that to be the case.
I mean, me and Steph, like, we moved out to the suburbs our last 2 years in New York. We were in Rye, and it was great. Like, it felt a little bit more like a neighborhood-ish feel. Our first year down here, we weren't sure if we were, like, I grew up in Minnesota.
Yeah.
We weren't sure if we were going to like not having winter, and I don't know if we'll ever leave the Valley now.
It's amazing, but how many former athletes, and I find especially hockey players, retire out here, which is why some of these youth hockey programs, they're super teams, because every kid on the team is the son of a former NHL player. It's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, you ever go through a winter in Minnesota, you go through one winter here in Arizona, it's pretty easy to decide which one you want to do for the rest of your life.
Yeah, so you're here, you're in, right? We got you for good now?
Yeah.
That's the thing about the Valley. Once we get you, you're in.
Yeah, the Valley sinks its claws in.
It's nice.
Yeah.
It's good. What's it like to be a New York Ranger? Let's go Rangers!
Yeah.
Like all the stuff that comes with that, because it's a lot.
It was a little bit of a whirlwind for me my first year. I went from Shattuck St. Mary's in the middle of Faribault, Minnesota. I got a little bit bigger world than the University of Wisconsin. Wasn't sure where I was going to end up when I signed a pro contract, if I was going to be in the minors or if I was going to go play another year in the junior, end up living in the city for the year as a 20-year-old. From there, everything just escalated so quickly. And the organization itself, obviously original six team, first of all, it was super cool to be drafted by them. Something that my dad got to do.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Right,
your dad was drafted by the Rangers as well.
So it was a cool moment for me. And then, to be able to wear that Ranger jersey is something that it's obviously a big part of my life, big part of my family's life. And it's something that I'll never forget. And I'm obviously grateful for.
Did you have those moments at first where, like, Madison Square Garden?
Wow. Well, you know what? Honestly, old MSG, when I first started playing there, it was kind of like, oh, this is cool. This building's got so much history. It's something that I was like kind of same thing as when I moved into the city, kind of wide eye and didn't really know how to handle it. And then they did the renovations, and then now MSG is just like this amazing place that they did a great job of renovating it and making it even more special than it already is.
But sometimes they blow that and they make it too corporate and too comfortable and too cushiony.
Right.
And you lose some of the edge, which I imagine is very important in a game like hockey.
Right.
Because that happened in Boston with the old Boston Garden and the new Boston Garden.
Yeah. I think New York did a good job with it. I don't think they lost that edge. I think it's got its polish that it needed, and it kept that history. I mean, you still have the big walk up the ramp for the visiting teams, and so it kept a lot of that stuff, but it just polished itself a little
bit. That's one of the great things about hockey is the buildings.
Yeah.
Most of them are gone now.
Right.
Maple Leaf Gardens, Montreal Forum, the old Boston Garden. This place is legendary.
Yeah.
And the old MSG, too.
Yeah.
Has hockey lost anything by having those buildings go away?
Me personally, I think I love all the new buildings. I think it makes our game so much more enjoyable to watch for fans. I think the buildings are putting fans in spots to, you know, there's not bad spots in the building. And as a visiting team and as a player, the facilities are nicer for us, and it just makes life go round and round a little bit easier.
Every time you come here, you get a morning meditation. Are you going to switch it up this time?
Well, you know, I got a morning meditation last time. I don't know if you saw Rick Tocchet.
Yeah.
I ordered a morning meditation, and he gave me a hard time, said I should have an umbrella in it. He made me feel a little less masculine, frankly. He basically punched me in the face. So I'm going to stand my ground and have a morning meditation. It's great. You've come here all the time. You must know the morning meditation.
I'm not going to lie to you, I'm a coffee drinker, so I'm going to stick with coffee and maybe just a glass of water for me today.
Yeah, absolutely. Are you guys ready to order?
I'll do the traditional, please.
So how would you like your eggs?
I'll do them over medium.
And what kind of meat?
Let's do the bacon, please. Don't tell Talk I did the bacon.
Okay.
I did like something healthy, like super healthy.
Protein.
It is good, it's good.
What's changed the most for you since you've been a player?
It's just this pace and speed of the game. Maybe when I first came into the league, 4 to now guys are playing at 9. You know, that's how fast it's gotten.
Cup of Coffee is presented by First Watch Restaurants, the Daytime Cafe.
So what's it like to play for Rick Tocchet?
He's great. I mean, obviously he's a guy that's played a long time, so he gets, he knows our world a little bit. And, you know, he's a guy that, with a young group, he coaches nonstop. And I think that gets a little bit lost in our sport with the older teams. Some coaches come in and kind of just, you know, push lines out and let the veteran guys do their thing. And with our group, we need a guy that's constantly teaching. And I think it's just not in his DNA not to teach, regardless if you're, you know, 20 years old or 30 years old. He's going to continue to coach and teach. And that's something that I think last year, even with the ups and downs we had, he just continued and stayed consistent with that.
It seems like somewhere along the halfway point of last year, things started to click. It seemed like there was a noticeable difference between the Coyotes first half of last year and second half. Did you find that to be the case?
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing was, you know, we had a lot of new faces, a lot of important pieces and new roles. We were all kind of just trying to feel each other out. We didn't really know how our balancing act was going to work between all of us. And we got more comfortable as the year went on. You know, we filled our roles the way I think that the plan was set out to be, but it just took a little bit longer. And, you know, I think this year we're all more comfortable with it. We kept a lot of the same guys around, and, you know, that makes a big difference. When you're more comfortable, you're going to do your job a lot better.
And part of that job you have to do, right? Because now you've been in, what, ninth year now for you?
Yeah.
So you've still got a lot of hockey left, don't get me wrong, but now you've become one of the smart KG veteran guys on a very young team. What's that like for you?
Well, the funny thing is maybe a skill set of mine that I've always had, even as a young guy, is trying to be that smart KG player. Whether or not it be the young smart KG player or the wily old vet smart KG player, that's something that I always try to push for and I try to keep in my game. So, you know, at a younger age, I was doing all the same thing. So as I've gotten older, it's easier to stay consistent because I've already been doing it for so long. And the leadership and the veteran part of it just kind of comes along with the territory.
Now, you described Rick as an old school hockey guy, and I'm sure you played with some old school hockey guys when you first came up with the Rangers. Are there any old school hockey guys left still playing, or has the game changed and become more millennial and cell phones and that kind of a thing?
It's switching over for sure. There's a couple older guys left that I would consider probably unicorns now in our game. There's a couple out there. I'm just trying to think off the top of my head. A guy in Toronto, Patty Marleau, he's been around a long time. Obviously, the non-bearded Joe Thornton, he's been around a long time. So, there's definitely some more guys. I don't want to leave any guys out, but there's definitely some of those guys left that, you know, played in a completely different era than it is now. And the game has changed so much, too. I mean,
how's it changed? What's changed the most for you since you've been a player?
It's just this pace and speed of the game. It's gone from, you know, maybe when I first came in the league, a four to now guys are playing at nines. You know, that's how fast it's gotten. It's
the whole time.
Yeah, it's just gotten faster and faster each year. You know, the younger guys coming in, they all can skate. You know, you don't see as many guys that aren't able to move up and down the ice anymore. So it's all about speed now, and that's the way the game is kind of transformed. And, you know, it used to be about being big and strong and pushing people around, and now it's not that anymore.
You'd have big goons just parked on the blue line pushing bodies around. Now guys are just skating right by him.
Now it's just speed.
Thanks. How do you explain to people in Arizona what hockey means in the state of Minnesota?
I don't think Arizona is that far off, to be completely honest with you.
Good. It's interesting, in looking at your path to get here, I don't know if hockey factory is not necessarily a negative thing, but you are the storybook guy growing up in Minnesota, the frozen rink in the backyard, the whole thing, Mystery Alaska kind of a deal.
Yeah.
And then you're at the prep school, that's a hockey fact. The guys that have played at your school are ridiculous. The list of NHL alums is amazing. Then Wisconsin, one of the best college programs, New York Rangers.
Yeah.
It seemed like right from the get-go, you were destined to do this.
It's weird, too. Like, when I was going through it, like, each step didn't seem like I was the guy that was going to be taking the step, right? Like, when I was at Hastings High School, I thought I was going to stay at Hastings High School. And some family friends of ours came to us and said, you got to go take a look at it. And it just kind of landed in our lap, and we went to Shattuck. And when I committed to Wisconsin, there was no plan for me to go in right away. It was kind of like, we'll wait and see how it happens. And Kyle Turris signs a pro contract, and Coach Mike Eaves calls me, like, in the middle of summer randomly. He's like, actually, you're not going to junior. You're going to come in and play at Wisconsin now. And then after my sophomore year at Wisconsin, it was kind of like, well, should I sign? Should I not sign? New York's kind of like, why don't you go back? And we're not in a rush. And then they called me like a week later and was like, actually, you know what? We want you to sign. And then everything just kind of like snowballed. It wasn't like...
But that's just the universe, man. You're on a path and you're not in control.
It felt like that. It just kind of happened. And like I said, I'm pretty blessed to come into some great opportunities and took advantage of them.
How do you explain to people, because people in New York, I think, will get it. I'm not sure people in the Valley will, but how do you explain to people in Arizona what hockey means in the state of Minnesota?
Ooh.
To grow up in that culture,
right,
where it's part of the topography.
Yeah. You know, I don't think Arizona is that far off, to be completely honest.
Good.
I think the people that are in the hockey world are very similar to the people that are in the hockey world in Minnesota. Minnesota just has more people in the hockey world. It's what you do. It's when it's 20 below with a wind chill, you go into a hockey rink. You don't, there's nothing else to do, so all families are there. Kids are all playing hockey all the time. So I just think that as Arizona grows with it, it won't be that far off. There's not much difference between an Arizona hockey parent and a Minnesota hockey parent. And
the Arizona parent is just a little warmer.
Arizona parent just gets to get vitamin D while in between games one and two.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it's funny. Like that's the one thing that I probably caught me most off guard when I got here.
Wow, were you?
The hockey
surprised?
Market is not far off. I talked to Arizona hockey fans that are parents, and I mean they get it just as much as a Minnesota parent does. They're not far off, and that was probably the one thing that I was most surprised with.
Wow. But I imagine it's a little more pervasive in Minnesota. Like, you're talking about hockey people.
Yeah.
But in Minnesota, I think it might be a little
there's
more
just
pervasive
more of
with
them.
Just everybody.
Yeah, there's just more of them.
Wow.
And, you know, any hockey parent, whether it's Arizona or Minnesota, thinks they know everything. My dad, my mom thought it.
Well, your dad was a pretty good hockey player in his defense.
I would argue that.
Well, nice.
Yeah, hopefully he's not watching.
There you go, Dad.
Yeah.
How about that?
I would argue that. He was more of a tough guy, and
Was your dad a goon?
Oh, I was.
Oh,
yeah,
see, was there you go. Was, nice.
Kind of was. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, he...
I'm glad Rick Talk is not here to see this.
Yeah.
$1 million bacon. There you go.
There we are.
That's the $1 million bacon.
Is there anything else I can bring out at the moment?
That's tremendous.
Great. Thank you so much.
Dig in. Enjoy.
Thanks, here.
Yeah, so... yeah, I don't know. I hope Dad doesn't watch this, but
no, he's got to watch this, right?
I don't know.
Well, you played in New York. You're on TV all the time.
I've told him this before, but I don't know how much hockey he really played when he played.
Wow, he was just in the penalty box the whole time?
Spend a little bit of time there.
Now, I grew up in Boston, so
I'm sorry.
Whoa, dude!
What?
Step off! You're sorry.
Hey, listen.
New York, don't get a Boston, New York thing going, because I will win that battle.
I'm just saying.
Wow. But anyway, so I know all about college hockey. I used to love to go to the Bean Pot. And Wisconsin is a tremendous program. But college hockey's awesome.
It's the best.
I mean, it is the best, because you've got that collegiate atmosphere, the atmosphere of a college football or basketball game, and the speed and intensity of a hockey game. All in one.
Hey, he's preaching to the choir. Yeah. I'm a college hockey guy all the way through.
It's tremendous.
You know, I always get in arguments with the junior guys on our team saying that they missed out big time on, you have no idea what it's like to do like the college atmosphere on a Saturday, go to a football game. You know, you don't get that opportunities in junior and the games itself. When I was at Wisconsin, we were able to fill the building pretty well.
Oh, yeah.
And, we had some good teams. We actually lost to Boston College in the national championship my sophomore year.
Nice.
So you can understand why I'm not a huge fan of Boston.
Well, Boston's just way better, that's all.
Yeah.
My wife and I adopted this puppy, and now he's a year old and he's awesome. That's my boring dog story. You have an amazing dog story.
Yeah.
Tell me about how you got your dog and why. Now, this is really good. After last baseball season, my wife and I rescued a puppy, a little border collie mix. He was 8 weeks old when we got him. His name is Jon Snow, because he looks like Jon Snow from Game of Thrones.
You guys Game of Thrones fans?
Yeah. I'm not a like big, crazy sci-fi guy, but I really like Game of Thrones. You watch it?
Me and my wife actually got 6 seasons in a month and a half.
Todd Walsh did the same thing. Once you start watching, you're in, right?
Right, and we were told that it's hard to keep track, so we got through it the whole, like, in a month and a half, and we watched it every single night. We were new parents at the time, so when my son got down, we'd get like 3-4 episodes in, and we got through it in a month and a half or so. So we're big fans too.
My point being was, my wife and I adopted this puppy, and now he's a year old, and he's awesome. That's my boring dog story. You have an amazing dog story.
Yeah.
Tell me about how you got your dog and why.
So, we were at the Olympics in Sochi. I don't know if you remember all like the stray dog
issues.
Yeah,
they were everywhere.
They were everywhere. In all honesty, me and my wife, we didn't really do a whole lot. Like, we were there, we knew the background. We'd been talking about getting a dog. We were getting married that summer. We felt like we were both dog people. We wanted to, you know, have a dog at some point, but we wanted it to, you know, make sense. And we weren't sure if we were gonna adopt or if we were gonna pick one through a breeder. We didn't know. We were just kind of starting the process. And David Backus and Kelly Backus, his wife, did all the legwork. They knew that the stray dogs were there. And so we had a conversation, and mostly my wife saying it's happening wasn't much of a conversation.
You got outvoted 1-1.
Yeah, that
happens to me a lot.
It was pretty much, it was done. And I was on board for it, and Jake had to spend a month in St. Louis getting quarantined and shots. Jake had a bunch of parasites in his stomach because he was a street dog. He was, you know, essentially eating whatever he could find. So he had a little bit longer quarantine, and my wife flew to St. Louis during the year, flew back, and Jake's been in our house ever since.
And then you're hooked, right? He's part of, instantly part of the family. Yeah. Seems like he's been part of the family for as
you
long
know
as
what?
You've been
Honestly,
together.
We were just talking about it. It kind of feels like he kind of got pushed out a little bit as the third child now.
Yeah, you got a full load going.
But he's great. He's awesome with the kids. He's got a lot of energy, but we find ways to get it out of him. We always joke that he's got a little bit of a wild side to him. He gets all whipped up, but he's been great, and we can't imagine not having him. You know, both our parents were like, what are you guys doing? This is not, just go through a breeder. This is crazy, and now they all love him.
No, it's so much more rewarding when you don't go through a breeder. Breeders are fine, but when you can rescue a puppy, because ours came from a reservation here, an abandoned litter, and you give a puppy, a dog, a home, it seems so much more rewarding.
Right, and I truly believe that the dog knows it too.
Like, really?
I feel that Jake is extremely loyal. Like, he is, I mean, I could go on for days about it. He's been one of the greatest things that me and my wife decided to do, which was kind of out on a limb. We didn't really know what we were doing, and it turned out to be one of the great things.
Good for you guys. That's awesome. It's great that he gets along with the kids.
Yeah, he's, you know what, he kind of takes a beating, but it's part of it.
That's awesome. Yeah. Thanks for doing this.
Yeah,
man.
No, thanks for having
Appreciate
me.
It.
Thanks for free breakfast. You got your credit card. You could set
No,
it
no, they take good care of us here.
I was kind of told that you were picking it up. They kind of told me that it was going to come
out of you. Just ganging up on me. I'll see what I can do. I'll expense it.